Hello students, welcome to my lecture series on reinforced concrete structures. In this class, I am going to discuss about a complete design of singly reinforced rectangular beams. Outcomes of today's class is, on completion of this class, you will be able to design the singly reinforced simply supported rectangular beam by considering all aspects like shear design, development length, and anchorage lengths, and what are the aspects we have for designing of simply supported beam. All those aspects are considered, and finally you have to design a simply supported, singly reinforced rectangular beam. So regarding last class, we have discussed that about what are the steps are there for designing this simply supported rectangular, singly reinforced rectangular beam. Based on those steps, we have to design today what is the singly reinforced rectangular beam is. Right. For designing the singly reinforced rectangular beam, I have chosen one problem that, so a design a rectangular simply supported reinforced concrete beam over a clear span of 6 meters if the superimposed load is 12 kN per meter and support width is 230 mm. Use M20 grade concrete and Fe415 steel. Here, I want to design the shape of the beam is rectangle and which is supported over a 2 simple supports. That's why I can call it as a simply supported beam, right? It is a RCC beam. And what is the span of the beam? Span of the beam is, that is a clear span. It is not effective span. So it is a clear span. Based on the clear span, we have to calculate what is the effective span is. And it has given imposed load. As I already discussed that, imposed load nothing but a live load. And based on the self weight of the beam, we can calculate what is the dead load. By adding live load and dead load, we will get the total load. And what is the value of imposed load is given? 12 kN per meter. And the support width is 230 mm. As I told you, the definition of simply supported beam is a beam supported over a 2 simple support. For each support width is 230 mm. For constructing this beam, what type of concrete I am using here? I am using M20 grade concrete and reinforcing material as a steel. What is the grade of steel I am using? Fe415. So according to this problem, then now I will write what are the given data is. Say here it is a L equal to 6 meter. It is a clear span. It is a clear span. And imposed load or the live load is equal to 12 kN per meter. It is given in the problem. And a characteristic strength of a steel, that is Fy equal to 415 newton per mm square, that is depends upon the grade of steel. And characteristic compressive strength of a concrete is 25 newton per mm square. Sorry, it is M20, I think it is a problem, M20. And the support width is 230 mm. Right. So let's start our steps one by one. Calculate the overall depth. First step is calculate the overall depth. Assuming, first we have to assume, this we can take from stiffness criteria or by using our designer consideration. So here I am taking experiences based on the designs. I have chosen the overall depth of the beam is, that is L by 12 to L by 15. Here L is given length of the beam. The given length of the beam is, that is 6 meters. So if I convert it to mm, that will be 6000 mm. Well, among these two, I have chosen that assume overall depth is equal to L by 12. In place of L, if I substitute, that is 6 meters, then nothing but 6000 mm divided it by 12, then I will get the overall depth equal to 500 mm. Then based on that, I have to calculate what is the width of the beam. So generally, this criteria also assumed based on the designer experiences, right? That can be chosen the B value between half of overall depth to the 1/3 of overall depth. So I'm choosing here for this design B equal to half of overall depth. I know from the previous step what is the overall depth is B equal to 500 by 2. So half of that, that will be width, that is B equal to 250 mm. Then the third step is calculate the effective depth of the beam. So dear students, remember that in the problem he has not mentioned anything regarding the cover. For that, I am assuming effective cover as 15 mm. And when you are designing practically, that this value of effective cover or a clear cover, it depends upon the type of exposure condition. Based on the exposure condition, there is a IS code provision. Based on that, you have to choose the your cover value. So I have chosen randomly here. The assumed effective cover is 50 mm. So to calculate the effective depth of the beam, that should be effective cover should be deducted from the overall depth. That is, small d is equal to capital D minus effective cover. And if you substitute that value, small d equal to 500 minus 50, that will give me the 450 mm is the effective cover, small d. Right. So this is assumed one. This value, whether sufficient or not, we have to check later on, later steps. So before that, we have to calculate what are the total load acting on the beam. And here, and step number 4, in the problem it is given that it is a clear span, but in the designing procedure we will use effective span is. So this effective span is depends upon the type of beam. In this consideration, in this type of, in this class, I am going to discuss about design of singly reinforced simply supported beam. So for the simply supported beams, there is a criteria for calculating effective span as per IS 456-2000, that is as per class number 22.2, there are two criteria to calculate effective span. The first criteria will be center to center of supports, and second criteria is clear span plus effective depth. So the value obtained from these two criteria are taken as effective depth. Which value you have to take? The minimum of these two values. So let us calculate what are those values are here. So first take the first criteria is center to center of the supports. So this center to center of support means I have given one example here, one figure here. So this is a simply supported beam. This is a support width and this is a support width. Those width, both width are equal, and is capital L is the clear span. So the first criteria is center to center of support. So the center to center of support, the effective length can be calculated L equal to this clear span plus half of width of this support and half of width of this support, that is L equal to capital L plus B by 2 plus B by 2. So this B by 2 will become 1B. So I can write L equal to capital L plus B. Same thing I have written here. L is capital L is 6000 mm and 1 plus 2 half width equal to 1 full width. So 1 full width value I have substituted here, that is 230 mm. If you add together, I will get 6230 mm. Sorry, it is mm. Please correct it. It is mm. 6230 mm. This is one criteria. And the second criteria is clear span plus effective depth. Clear span plus effective depth. So that is capital L plus small d. So according to this, what is the capital L? 6000 mm. And already we have decided what is the effective depth of the beam is, that is 450. So if you add together, we will get 6450 mm. So what is our criteria for choosing the effective length? Minimum of this tool. By comparing above two values, that is one value is 6230 mm, another is 6450 mm. The less among these two is 6230 mm. So the effective length of this particular beam considered as a 6230 mm. So this we have calculated according to the class number 22 of IS 456-2000. Hereafter, in this problem, effective length means effective span length, that is related to the simply supported beam. That value, wherever you get a small l or effective length, here in this problem, you have to substitute, that is 6230 mm. The next step is load calculation. So the dimensions of the actual dimensions of beams are depends upon the load calculations. As you know, the design nothing but there is a three parameters we have to calculate. One is width of the beam, another is a depth of the beam, and a third one is area of cross section of a stencil steel reinforcement area we have to calculate, that is AST. Right. So those will be calculated based on this load calculation. That means what amount of load is acting on that beam. For that particular load only we have to calculate. Based on that load we can calculate the factor load or maximum load. Based on the maximum load we have to calculate the factored bending moment or maximum bending moment. To counteract that bending moment, what will be the percentage area of steel reinforcement provided, and what are the dimensions should be provided for the cross section of a beam. Those things we can calculate based on these loads. So I told you that there are two type of loads. Basically, we will consider that is dead load, or you can say it is a self weight of the beam, and second one is a live load. So dead load can be calculated by using this formula, that is width of the beam multiplied by overall depth multiplied by unit weight of RCC. So here, if you substitute all those values, width of the beam is 250, overall depth is 500, and unit weight of concrete you have taken is 25 kilonewton per meter cube. Finally, the obtained value, that is dead load, equal to 3.125 kilonewton per meter. Per meter length of a beam, this much of dead load will be acting, otherwise this much will be the self weight of that particular beam, we can say. Then we have to calculate live load. He has given in the problem in the term with a term called imposed load, that imposed load also known as a live load. So that given in the problem is 12 kilonewton per meter. Now I want to calculate total load which is acting on the beam, that is live load plus dead load, that equals dead load is 3.125 and dead load is 3.125 plus your live load is 12. If we add together, we will get the total load value is 15.125. This is total load. Then we have to calculate the another step, calculation of design loads and moments. Based on the total load, we have to calculate design load and design moments. So in the problem, it is given that it is a simply supported beam subjected to UDL throughout. So for that, the design load will be WU. I can call it as a factor load also. So generally, factor load can be calculated by using the partial factor of safety given in as per IS 456-2000 in limit state of collapse in flexure condition. That is, when you are using combination of dead load and live load, that value will be 1.5. The total load what we obtained in our previous slide will be multiplied with a 1.5. Then we get what is 1.5 into 15.125 is equal to 22.687 kilonewton per meter. So based on this factor load value, you have to calculate what is the factored bending moment is, that is MU. So when you simply supported beam subjected to UDL throughout, the maximum bending moment will occur at the center of the beam. This concept you have already learnt in your strength of material subject. That there will be a direct formula, this is WL square by 8. Here we are calculating factored bending moment, means we have to use load, a factor load. Then the formula will be modified as WL square by 8. So according to this one, WU equal to 22.687, and here L is the effective length. Effective length we have calculated is minimum of those two criteria. The minimum value is 6.23 meters. That is 6230 mm. Then I convert that 6.23 meters, and here L square we have so square of that, and whole by 8. If you simplify this values, will get 110.06 kilonewton into meter, or I can write in terms of newton into mm, that is 110.06 into 10 power 6 newton into mm. So this is all about our calculation of design loads and design moments. Right. Next, we have to calculate limiting moment of resistance. You know, the moment of resistance is, that is, resistance to moment is limit, moment of resistance. Then what is the limiting moment of resistance? The definition of limiting moment of resistance is the moment of resistance calculated with respect to limiting depth of neutral axis. So that is a maximum depth of neutral axis of a beam. Then I can call it as a limiting moment of resistance. So why should we calculate this value in this particular design of a singly reinforced simply supported rectangular beam? The purpose is we have to decide first what type of beam section it is. I mean, how, what is the failure mode of this beam will be, whether it is fails in compression, whether it is fails in tension, or it will be become a balanced. So that means those are called, based on those failure modes, the beam sections are classified as three types. One is a balanced section, under reinforced section, and over reinforced section. As I already discussed about when we say balanced section, when we call it as the under reinforced section, when we call it as a over reinforced section. So I don't want to go in details about this. Just I've entered into the problem here. It is to calculate deciding the type of beam section, right? So for calculating this limiting moment of resistance, we have some ready-made formula as per IS 456-2000. It can be calculated by using these formulas. So that is depend upon the FCK, that is the characteristic strength of a concrete, width of the beam, effective depth of the beam, and grade of concrete. After knowing the grade of steel, that is, if you are using 250 grade of steel, that is 0.148 FCK BD square, And if you are using Fe415 steel, then the formula for calculating limiting moment of resistance is 0.138 fck/bd². And similarly, if you are using Fe500 steel, then the formula for calculating limiting moment of resistance is 0.133 fck/bd². So in this problem, I am using a grade of steel is Fe415 and grade of concrete is 20 m20, so that is 20 newton for mm². If I substitute all those values in this formula, I will get 0.138 multiplied by grade of concrete is 20 and B is 250 and effective depth is 450 square. And if I calculate that, here I will get mu limit equal to 139.725 × 10⁶ newton into mm. So from our previous slide, we have calculated what is the limiting factor bending moment is. So factored bending moment value is 110.06 × 10⁶, and your limiting bending moment value is 139.725 × 10⁶. So if you compare these two, your factored bending moment value is well below the limiting moment of resistance value. So I can say the mu is less than mu limit. So based on the conditions given in IS 456000 to 2000, in this problem, this beam section will satisfy this condition. So this condition of beam can be called as a under reinforced section. What you can call under reinforced section. So the failure mode will be tensile failure. We have to calculate moment of resistance with respect to that tensile or steel, we can say. Right. So next we have to calculate based on the obtained moment of resistance value, limiting moment of value and factored bending moment value, we can calculate required effective depth is. What do you mean by required effective depth? So in our first or second step, we have assumed what is the effective depth is. That is a assumed one. It may be a true or it may be a false. It may be a acceptable or unacceptable. That we can check by this step. So whether for given dimension of beam or for given grade of concrete and assumed dimension, so what actually we require, what is the minimum depth of required, minimum effective depth required for this particular section, that can be calculated by using a principle called equating the maximum bending moment to the limiting moment of resistance. So we know that maximum bending moment or factored bending moment value mu is equal to K into Fck into Bd². The K value depends upon the grade of steel. Those values are mentioned here, right? And if you rearrange the term, I want to calculate what is the required effective depth. Small d is equal to under root of mu by K into Fck into B, right? So in the problem, the grade of steel is given is Fe415 and mu we have already calculated, that is 110.06, and according to K value, the grade of steel K value is 0.138 and grade of concrete is 20 m20, so width is 250. If you calculate these values, we'll be get the depth required, the minimum depth required is 399.38 mm, right, which the value which is less than the assumed value, right. Finally, we can write here the effective depth required, that is less than the provided depth. So go for further step. If not, we can take whatever the minimum depth required value we obtained, those value we can choose as effective depth and we go for the further step. So based on these steps, we got that our effective depth required is less than assumed depth. So we can assume the assumed depth 450 is the appropriate depth for go for further step. Right. Next, we have calculated, we have checked that our obtained B value and obtained D value are well sufficient for this beam. So we have to calculate now other parameter in the design. We have calculated two parameters, that is B and D. Next parameter for related to design of beam is area of tension reinforcement. So for the obtained moment of ultimate moment, the area of steel can be calculated by using these two formulas, that is mu equal to 0.87 Fy AST D into 1 minus Fy AST by BD into Fck, or we have another formula AST equal to 0.5 Fck by Fy into 1 minus under root of 1 minus 4.6 mu by Fck Bd² whole into BD. So here I have given two formulas, you can use either of one. But I will explain the difficulty in this using these two formulas. So if I use the first formula, here I will get a quadratic equation. right? That is some a t square, some b x plus c like that. So it is a calculation of this is little difficult. The calculation required time. It is a time consuming. So better to use this formula. You can easily remember this straight away. If you substitute the formulas in this equation, we will get the direct value of AST. But if you are using this formula, means we will get two factor of this quadratic equation. We will take the positive factor of that, and from that we can consider whatever the AST value is for the further proceedings. So whatever the AST value obtained from these and AST value obtained from these, both are same. So don't worry about this. You can use either of one formula, but for your betterment sake or easy sake, I am using this formula. Directly we can get the what is the AST value is. Here it is a quadratic equation. That equation we have to solve, and finally we have to calculate what is the AST is. So that is the convenience of this formula with respect to this one, right? So if I substitute all those values here, I will get the area of steel is 791 mm square. So AST required for particular section is 791 mm square. So now I have calculated what is the B, what is the D, and AST. Is my design is over? No. Obtained values are whether they are safe against the applied load or they are well within the permissible limits of the code or not. We have to check that. So now we go for check of these values. Next, you check for minimum area of reinforcement. So as per codal provision, we have to provide for any cross section, we have to provide this much of minimum area of tension reinforcement. What is that? AS. According to the class number 26.5.1.1 of A, IS 456-2000, the minimum area of steel reinforcement provided should be like this. That is AS by BD equal to 0.85 FY. From that I can calculate what is AS is. So according to the given problem, I will calculate what is AS is. So AS, I don't know, that value I have to calculate, and I know what is the B and D, that is 250 multiplied by 50, that equal to 0.85, and I know what is FI is, that is 415. After calculating this, I got that the minimum area of tension reinforcement is 236 mm square. The minimum area of tension reinforcement to be provided for the particular dimensions are, this area is minimum, that is a sufficient. However, the value obtained should not be less than this value. That is, AS should not be AS value should be the obtained value should not be less than this minimum area of reinforcement, that is AS. Our obtained value is 791, but the minimum area of tension reinforcement required is 236. So our condition exists is our AS is less than AST. So the obtained value of AST is okay with our it is self-sufficient in terms of minimum area of tension reinforcement provided. So then we go for maximum area of tension reinforcement provided. For this also we have one condition as per IS 456-2000, that is clause number 26.5.1.1 of B. The maximum area of tension reinforcement shall not be exceed 0.04 of BD. So this is a small b, actually capital D, some topographical mistake here. Alright, so I can write it as a 4% of gross cross-sectional area. So small b is the breadth of that beam and d is the overall depth of the beam. AST of 10 should be this value, less than this value. So according to this value, what will the maximum area of reinforcement we can provide? So I have calculated based on those dimensions. 0.04 multiplied by 250 is the b and capital D is the 500. Up to 5000 mm square, I can provide. It is the maximum value of the tension reinforcement that I can provide it. But no case the obtained value of tension reinforcement should not exceed this value. That should be less than the 4% of BD, that is 5000 mm square, according to this particular problem. The obtained value of AST is 791. The maximum value of AST is 5000. So our 791 is well below the 5000 mm square. Hence it is okay in terms of maximum area of tension reinforcement provided, right? So we have checked with respect to reinforcement. Then we go for spacing of the bars or number of bars provided, that is the main bars, right? Here for calculating the spacing of the bar, we have to choose one diameter of bar, and that diameter of bar should be chosen based on the IS 456-2000 criteria only, right? So the number of bars can be calculated equal to area of steel provided area of steel obtained by number of area of 1 bar. For this problem, I have chosen the diameter of bar is 20 mm. The area of steel corresponding to this 20 mm is 721 mm square. Or the area of steel required is 791 mm square in this particular problem. And area of 120 mm bar is 314 mm square. By using this ASC required and number area of one particular bar, I can calculate what is the number of bars are. So the AST by area of one bar, if you substitute that 791 by 314, so if I calculate that, I will get 3.51. So I cannot provide the bars in terms of what in terms of fractions. So I have to provide it in terms of what round figure, say it is 2.5 fraction, means I can round it out to higher value. So number of bars provided is 3 numbers of 20 mm bar. So this is area of required, this area is sufficient, but we are providing more than that area, that is we are increasing the half bar extra, so that by the 3 number of bars. So area related to this AST provided is 3 times of a single bar area, 3 times 314. So actual area provided is 942 mm square. So this is how we can calculate the area of steel required and area of steel provided and number of bars required by using this step. Next, after calculating all those provided spacing for bars, number of bars we have calculated, area of steel we have calculated, and we have checked against a minimum area and maximum area, whether our designed beam is safe against the deflection or not, that we can check again. So the deflection value, the deflection the safety against the deflection can be checked by considering two values. That is PT, that is percentage of steel, that can be calculated 100 AST provided by BD. Another is stress in steel under the service loads. So first we have to calculate what is the percentage of steel provided. Already we have calculated what is the AST provided, that divided by effective area of the beam, that is B into D, that will give me the percentage of steel. That is 100 into AST provided is 942 by B is 250 and D is 450. From that I can get what is the percentage of steel is 0.83%. And one more condition I have to calculate is stress in steel under the service load. What is the stress will induce due to the service load in the beam? That is, that can be calculated by using this formula. This formula is given in your IS 456-2000. Fs equal to 0.58 Fy into AST required by AST provided. You know the difference between AST required and AST provided is. So anyhow, I will explain here. AST required nothing but what actual number of bars are required for that particular beam, that is the required. But if you get any fraction, suppose in this problem you have got that the actual number of bars required is 2.5 something. For that you have got 791 mm square area. But 2.5 bars we cannot provide practically. So we are rounding up to the 3 bars. The area corresponding to the rounding up to 3 bars is 942 mm square. So this area is actually provided, but this area is actually required. So I got that, you got the clear difference between these two. So if you substitute all those, so 0.58 into 415 is Fy and AST required is 791, AST provided is 942. If we calculate, we will get Fs, that is stress in steel under the service load, equal to 202 Newton per mm square. By using these two values and by using the graph provided in IS 456-2000, we have to calculate what is the modification factor. Based on the modification factor, we have to calculate what is the L by D ratio maximum and what is the L by D ratio provided. Based on those two relations of L by D ratio provided and L by D ratio maximum, we can calculate whether it is safe against the deflection or not. So let's check here. From obtained Fs and PT, calculate the modification factor. PT value we get is 0.83%, and Fs corresponding to the from this graph. So the Fs we have in this graph, three parameters we check. One is percentage tension reinforcement, modification factor, and these curves are given corresponding to the steel stress of service loads in Newton per mm square. If you see in the graph, the values are 120, Fs equal to 120, 145, 190, 240 and 290. And percentage of steel corresponding to the 0.4, 0.8, 1.2, 1.6, like that. But the obtained values are not exactly matching this graphical values. They are falling somewhere between. So we, by using interpolation technique, we can calculate what is our desired value is. Say the percentage of steel is 0.83%, and this is somewhere here, this is 0.8, and 0.83 is here, and our FS value is falls between 190 and 240. So the value corresponding 0.83, if you take the 190 Newton for mm square, that will be somewhere, that is here. 190 is here. So that is about, say, 1.2, 1.4 and 1.6. It is in between 1.2 and 1.4. It is somewhere here. So I can write that value approximately chosen is 1.35. And the value corresponding to the 0.83% of steel and FS of 240. So here, again, if you project our vertically onto this graph, it will getting here, somewhere here. So it has been between 1 and 1.2. Say I have chosen a approximate value of 1.15. So based on these values, by taking interpolation technique, we can calculate what is the that is modification factor corresponding to the 0.83% of steel and FS equal to 202 Newton for mm square. So this is the interpolation technique what I used here. That is 1.35 minus 1.15 by 240 into 190 whole multiplied by 202 minus 190. I got from this the modification factor value is 1.30. So from this, I need to calculate what is the L by D maximum. How much maximum percentage of that L by D ratio can be provided. So that value can be calculated by L by D maximum is equal to basic value multiplied by your modification factor. So basic value, where, what is this basic value? This basic value with respect to stiffness of the beam, that will be depend upon the type of beam. So here I have given the some basic values. These are also based on the IS 456-2000. For cantilever 7, simply supported 20, and continuous beam it is 26. As we are designing the simply supported rectangular beam, so the simply supported basic value will be 20. So L by D maximum can be calculated, that basic value multiplied by modification factor, and modification factor is already obtained from this interpolation technique. Then basic value equal to 20 multiplied by 1.3 is a modification factor. Then the L by D maximum obtained is 26. Then we have to check L by D provided. L by D provided means L is effective length, D is effective depth. So we know what is effective length is, that is 6230 mm, and our effective depth is 450 mm. If you calculate the ratio of that, you will get the factor, that is 13.84. if you observe these two values, our L by D maximum is greater than L by D provided, hence it is okay. So finally I can say our design beam is safe against the deflection. Right, next we have to design the shear reinforcement for particular designed beam. Right, first we have to determine for design the shear reinforcement, we have to calculate what is the shear forces, because our shear and intention of shear reinforcement is to resist the shear force which is coming onto the beam, and this shear force we have to calculate. This shear force will depend upon the support condition and type of loading, and we have to calculate what is the ultimate shear forces. So in this problem, we are designing simply supported rectangular beam, and it is subjected to UDL, and loading condition is UDL, and type of beam is simply supported. So for this, the maximum shear force occur at the support, that is VU equal to WUL by 2. W already we have calculated in our previous steps. So that is 22.687 into your effective length is 6.23 by 2. We'll get the factored shear force value is 70.67 kilonewtons. So after calculating that, I need to calculate what is the nominal shear stresses. The according to the code, clause number 40.1 of IS 456, the tau V can be calculated VU by BD. Already we have calculated what is VU is 70.637 into 10 cube by, we know what is the B and D value. If substitute that, we'll get 0.62 Newton for mm square. So after calculating that nominal shear stress value, we have to calculate maximum shear stress, and we have to compare the nominal shear stress value and maximum shear stress value. Why should we compare? After comparing that, whether we go for providing the shear reinforcement or not, whether the chosen dimension of or obtained dimension of beams are adequate for providing shear reinforcement or not, that we have to check. So this maximum shear stress value is depends upon the grade of concrete. As in this problem, I have taken the grade of concrete is M20. For M20 grade of concrete, tau maximum value is this is. So M20 grade concrete tau max is 2.8. So 2.8 newton for mm square. The tau we calculated is 0.62 and tau max is 2.80. So our tau we is less than tau c max. So I can say that from this. The dimensions what we have calculated for the beam are adequate for design shear design consideration. If the case is reverse, that is, if tau e is greater than tau c max, then we have to revise our section and we have to revise our dimension and then we go for further steps. So we have to now have to calculate percentage of steel. That is, percentage of steel can be calculated, that is 100 AST by BD and 100, you know, what is the AST provided is, and B, you know, from that you can calculate 0.83%. This step already we have calculated when we are checking again is the deflection, right? Now we have to calculate design shear strength. The design shear strength value depends upon the grade of concrete and percentage of tensile reinforcement. As in the problem, the percentage of tensile reinforcement is 0.83 and the grade of concrete used is M20. So for that 0.83, there is no exact value in that tabular form which is given in IS 456-2000. For by using interpolation technique, we can calculate what is the value of design shear strength tau cg is. After interpolating polation of that values, we will get the design shear strength of concrete for the 0.83% of tensile reinforcement is 0.59 newton for mm square. Now again, this value should be compared with the nominal shear stress value. Now our nominal shear stress value tau v is greater than tau c. Hence, we have to definitely go for design of shear reinforcement. Suppose the case is reverse, that is tau c is greater than tau v. Then we have to provide the shear reinforcement, but not by using design procedures. Only nominal reinforcement we have to provide. That is according to the IS 456-2000 conditions. So in this case, our nominal shear force is greater than your design shear strength of a concrete. So hence we have to go for design of shear reinforcement. So for design of shear reinforcement, we have to calculate what is the shear resisting capacity of a concrete and shear to be resisted by the shear reinforcement. Right, this 70.67 newton for kilonewton is the total shear force to be resisted by whole beam section. In the beam section we have steel as well as a concrete. In that, what is the shear resisting capacity of a concrete and what is the shear resisting capacity of a shear reinforcement, we have to calculate separately. Then based on the shear resistance capacity of a shear reinforcement, we have to design the shear reinforcement. Right, so let us calculate what is the shear resistant capacity of a concrete. That can be calculated by using VC equal to tau C into BD. After substituting those values, we will get the shear resisting capacity of concrete VC is equal to 66.375 kilonewtons. And then calculate shear resisting capacity of a shear reinforcement. So this will be VU is the total shear force to be resisted by concrete as well as steel. But from this I have to calculate what is the shear reinforcement to be resisted by shear reinforcement alone. Then from this total shear reinforcement, I have to deduct what is the shear resisting capacity of a concrete. So then I will get the shear resisting capacity of a shear reinforcement, that is 4.295 kilonewtons. So based on this value, I can calculate what is the number of legs for stirrup, what is the spacing for stirrup, and those things we have calculated based on this shear resisting capacity of a shear reinforcement. So then the design for shear reinforcement, in this case our nominal shear stress is greater than tau c, definitely we go for shear design. For this, let us assume the 8 mm dia two legged vertical stirrups are provided. For this particular vertical stirrups of 8 mm diameter, that area of that total cross sectional area of stirrup legs in effective shear is pi by 4 into d square. As they are having two legs, so multiplied by 2, the area obtained for this is 100.5 mm square. So based on these values, we have to calculate what amount of spacing we have to provide it. For providing spacing, we have to follow three criteria. That is, first criteria will be spacing of stirrups to resist the shear shear force which is to be resisted by the provided shear reinforcement. From that, spacing can be calculated SV equal to 0.87 FI ASV into D by VUS. If you substitute the values, all those things, 0.87 FI the steel grade, ASV the area of steel rough, and 450 the effective depth, V is the shear resisting capacity of a shear reinforcement. If you calculate according to this, you will get 3801 mm is the spacing. The second criteria is spacing from minimum shear reinforcement consideration. As we are not providing minimum shear reinforcement, but we have to calculate what is the spacing with respect to this condition, then if you substitute that value SV equal to ASV into 0.87 FY by 0.4 into B, the value obtained is SV equal to 362 mm. And the third criteria is maximum spacing allowed. There is a two sub criteria, those are 0.75D and 300 mm. We have to provide minimum of these two. If you calculate the first criteria, 0.7 into effective depth is 450, then we will get the spacing, maximum spacing allowed with respect to this is 337.5, and another is 300. So lesser value will be taken in this. Now the spacing to be provided. Finally, after designing the shear reinforcement, how much spacing should be provided? Then we will take the minimum value of this ABC. If you take AB value is 3801 and B value is 362 and C value is 300, so we have to provide spacing is 300 mm. Hence, provide two legged 8 mm diameter stirrups at 300 mm center to center. So it is spacing okay. Then we have to check our design with respect to development length at a simply supported positive moments of a reinforcement. So according to the class number 26.2.3.3 of IS 456-2000, there are one class is there, that is provided a development length LD should be less than or equal to MI by V plus L0, or if you are having a reaction from the compressive reinforcement, then this MI value can be increased by 30%. So that value, that formula will be written like this. Our development length should be less than or equal to 1.3 MI by V plus L0. Here MI is a moment of resistance. If all steel is stressed up to its maximum value, that is 0.87 FY, and V is the shear force at the support, L0 is the anchorage length, and this anchorage length is depends upon the diameter of bar and angle of bent. And this anchorage nothing but providing or bending the bars in terms of bends with some inclination and standard hooks, that is a U-shaped hooks, that is called a anchorage, and length of that is called a anchorage length. And this anchorage length is, as I told you, depends upon angle of inclination and diameter of bar. Code says that for every 45 degrees of inclination, the length of the bar will be anchorage length of the bar will be provided is, that is 4 times its diameter, right? So that's it, this to check that agonist development is simply supported for positive moments, this condition should be satisfied. So let us check whether it is satisfied or not. So MI is, that is the moment of resistance what we have calculated, that is 110.06 kilonewton. Or we can say 110.06 in 10 power 6 newton into mm. The development length of 20 mm bar with M20 grade of concrete and Fe415 steel, that can be calculated by using this formula. And tau BD, as I told you, tau BD is depends upon the grade of concrete and this, what type of steel and where it is placed actually, right? Anyhow, we are providing, we are designing a singly reinforced beam, so reinforcement will be provided in tension zone. But what type of beam, what grade of steel you are providing? The grade of steel provided is 415 steel, but in the code it is given to design to determine the bond stress, the limit state of for plain bars in tension zone is provided. But based on this value, we can calculate what is the bond stress in HOST bar also. He has given some note values, that is, for if you provide a HOST bar in tension zone, then the obtained value with respect to the grade of concrete increased by 60%. So here M20 grade concrete and corresponding to Fe250, the value is 1.2, but I am providing HYSD bar in tension zone, so I am to increase this value by 60%. So this value can be obtained by 1.2 into 1.6 by 1 is equal to 1.92 newton for mm square. So if you substitute all those value in this formula, development length formula, the development length will be 940 mm. This value should be equal or less than that mi by that that value. This value, that is, that should be less than this value. Alright. Let us check whether it is satisfied the condition or not. So let us take LE less than or equal to 1.3 mi by V into N hat. I have calculated the supply 1.3 mi by V is 2024 and I am providing a 90 degrees bent. Say 90 degrees bent. So 90 degrees bent means it is not a 90 degrees, it is a 135 degree bent. I am providing anchorage into 135 degrees. The length of that will be 12.5. Why it is 12.5? For each 45 degrees 4 and I have bent into 135 degrees, so that 4 into 3, 12, 5 will be the total length of the anchorage length. That is 12 into 20 mm, that is 240 mm. And if 940 is must be less than or equal to 2024 plus 240, anyhow this value is more than these, so then hence this development criteria also satisfied. Then we see the detailing criteria. What do we calculate? What is the depth of the beam? What is the width of the beam? What is the number of main reinforcement bar are provided in the beam? And what is the width of the beam? What is the width of the support? And what is the stirrup spacing? What type of stirrups we have provided? Right, let us check in this. As it is a longitudinal section, it is a cross section of a beam. As where it is a 6 meter span, width of the beam is 230, width of the support is 230. And these are main bars what you have provided. And where we obtained that 3 number of bars at a diameter of 20 mm we have to provide. And the topmost bar is there. So we may get doubt that, sir, you have never taught about these bars in this whole lecture. There is no significance of this bar. There is no separate calculation of this bar in this design because it is a singly reinforced beam. Our interest is to calculate what is the amount of steel reinforcement provided in this particular tension zone only. But these bars are provided in compression zone. These bars are called hanger bars. They are just give you the support to this bar, to hold this bar in position and to make our stirrup around to this. We have to provide these hanger bars like this. So I am using the hanger bars, 2 numbers of bars at the edges of the beam, that is 10 mm of diameter each. There may be they are not having any functional importance in this singly reinforced beam, but they are used for purpose of holding the main reinforcement by means of stirrups. That's it. So the stirrup specification of stirrups of 2 legged 8 mm diameter, and I have calculated spacing, that is 300 mm, the center of support, and see the cross section of this. The overall depth of beam is 500 mm, width of the beam is 250, and here 3 main reinforcement bars, 20 mm, and these 2 are the hanger bars. Around that, we are providing 2 legged stirrups, so leg 1, leg 2 of 8 mm diameter. So this is the complete design of a singly reinforced, simply supported rectangular beam. Thank you. That's all for today's lecture. Meet again.